Let us start our lecture series on Introduction to Radar Systems. Today's topic is Modified Radar Equation, Part 1. In this module, we will try to modify the radar equation that we have derived in our previous lecture. In previous lecture, we have derived the simple form of the radar equation along with certain failure or the discrepancies. Now we will discuss those discrepancies and we will try to modify the radar equation so that the radar equation would get or give us almost accurate value as that obtained from the experimental observations or practical values. That should be same as that of the practical values. So this was the actually equation that we have derived in previous lecture. R max is the maximum range of the radar target. So it is equal to PTG A sigma divided by 4 pi square S mean whole to the power 1 by 4. It is the transmitted power, G is the antenna gain, A is the antenna effective aperture, sigma is the radar cross section, S mean is the minimum detectable signal in watt. Now consider the failure of radar equation. We will try to determine some reasons and we will try to determine or find some remedies for those failures. The failure of the radar equation to explicitly include the various losses that can occur throughout the system. The loss in performance usually experienced when electronic equipment is operated in the field rather than under laboratory type conditions. And another important factor is the statistical or unpredictable nature of several of the parameters in the radar equation. The minimum detectable signal S mean and the target cross section sigma are both statistical in nature and must be expressed in statistical terms. In previous equation, we have assumed this S mean and sigma are as if just numbers, but actually they are not just numbers. We have to determine them in different fashion. They are the statistical parameters. Other statistical factors which do not appear explicitly in the simple radar equation but which have an effect on the radar performance are the meteorological conditions along the propagation path and the performance of the radar operator if one is employed. Nowadays almost all the radars are automated, but in previous days radar operators were there and the performance of the radar operator was also we have to consider for the determination of the performance of the radar. The statistical nature of these several parameters does not allow the maximum radar range to be described by the single number. Its specification must include a statement of the probability that the radar will detect a certain type of target at a particular range. Hence, in order to cover these aspects, the simple radar equation will be modified to include most of the important factors that influence radar range performance. So that is our job. So first consider minimum detectable signal. The ability of a radar receiver to detect a weak echo signal is limited by the noise energy that occupies the same portion of the frequency spectrum as does the signal energy and accompanies the signal. The weakest signal the receiver can detect is the minimum detectable signal. It is difficult to define minimum detectable signal because of its statistical nature and because the criterion for deciding whether a target is present or not is not too well defined. Detection is normally based on establishing a threshold level at the output of the receiver. So we will consider this figure. understand this. Whenever receiver output signal, which is a mixture of echo and noise, crosses this threshold, then it is detected as target. This type of detection is called the threshold detection. So consider the output of the typical radar receiver as a function of time, which is the output shown, video output shown in a scope display. So this is the output of the, this is the radar signal, signal plus noise. RMS value of noise that we can calculate, say here. Now we set this threshold right here. This is the threshold. So accordingly, whenever the signal will be above the threshold, that will be detected as target. So here the signal level is above the threshold, so this one will be treated as target, say target A. Here the signal is slightly above the threshold, this one is also treated as another target, target B. But here, though it is a peak, but the signal is just below the threshold, so it will not be treated as target, valid target. Now try to understand the problem, basic problem. The envelope has fluctuating appearance due to the random nature of noise and consists of, say, three targets ABC of different signal amplitudes. Here, the return coming from this target A is so large that compared to noise, that it can be detected without any ambiguity or any disturbances. So it is sure that there is a target because the signal energy is very, very large. Now assume the target B and C, they are returning the same amount of signal, but noise associated with signal at B and signal at C are different. That means original signal was same for B target and C target, but noise are different. So let us see what happens. So B and C representing target echoes of equal amplitude, assuming the noise voltage accompanying the signal at B is large enough so that combination of signal plus noise exceeds the threshold and target detection is still possible. So signal plus noise becomes larger than the threshold, so B will also be treated as target. But for target C, the noise is not as large and the resultant signal plus noise does not cross the safe threshold, and hence target is not detected. Even it may happen that original signal of this target C may be above threshold voltage, but at that time the noise voltage is such that the resultant of the original signal plus noise becomes less than the threshold. It may also happen. That means there is a chance that, particularly when the signal voltage is very close to the threshold, that we can either miss a target, or it may happen that target is not there, but we can detect that particular part as a target. It depends on the threshold. That means setting of this threshold is very important. See, weak signals such as C would not be lost if the threshold level were lower. So if this threshold voltage is set at right here, then it might happen that C is above the threshold, so C will also be treated as target. There will be no problem. But too low a threshold increases the likelihood that the noise alone will rise above the threshold and is taken as target. For example, if we lower the lowering of threshold like right here, say here, so this one will be treated as target, this one will be treated as target, this one will be treated as target, though target is not there, this one will be treated as target. But actually target is not there, but we set the threshold at such low level that these peaks will also be treated as target. Such occurrence is called the false alarm. That means there was no target actually, but radar is detecting that particular portion as target. Therefore, if the threshold is too low, false target indications are obtained. But if it is set too high, the target might be missed. That means if the threshold is set right here, A target will be above the threshold, but B target will be below the threshold. So if you increase the target threshold level slightly, B will be below the threshold voltage. So B will be treated as simple noise. That means we will miss the target. But if it is too high, target might be missed. The selection of the proper threshold level is compromised. That depends upon how important it is. If a mistake is made either by failing to recognize a signal that is present, which is the probability of miss, or by falsely indicating the presence of a signal when it does not exist, it is the probability of false alarm. The signal to noise ratio necessary to provide adequate detection is one of the important parameters that must be determined in order to compute the minimum detectable signal. Although the detection decision is usually based on measurements at the video output, it is easier to consider maximizing the signal to noise ratio at the output of the IF amplifier rather than in the video. The receiver may be considered linear up to the output of IF. It is shown that maximizing the signal to noise ratio at the output of IF is equivalent to maximizing the video output. It is assumed that the IF filter characteristics approximates the matched filter so that the output signal to noise ratio is maximized. In your analog communication class, you have already gone through this digital communication class, you have already gone through this matched filter. So matched filter is actually used to maximize the signal to output signal to noise ratio at the receiver. So that is the job of IF right here. We will use IF to maximize the output signal to noise ratio. Now the receiver noise. What is noise? Noise is unwanted electromagnetic energy which interferes with the ability of the receiver to detect the wanted signal, thus limiting the receiver sensitivity. There exists an unavoidable component of noise generated by the thermal motion of the conduction electron in the ohmic portion of the receiver input stages. This is called thermal noise or Johnson noise, and is directly proportional to the temperature of the ohmic portion of the circuit and the receiver bandwidth. The available noise power generated by a receiver of bandwidth, say BN Hz, at a temperature capital T, absolute unit, is given by available thermal noise power equal to KT into BN, where K is the Boltzmann constant, 1.38 into 10 to the minus 23 joule per degree. If the temperature capital T is taken to be 290 Kelvin, that is the room temperature, the factor KT becomes 4 into 10 to the power 21 minus 21 watt per hertz of bandwidth. For radar receivers, the super heterodyne type, we have already seen that basic block diagram of the radar receiver, it is nothing but a super heterodyne receiver. Receiver bandwidth is approximately that of the intermediate frequency stages. It should be cautioned that the bandwidth BN mentioned above is not 3 dB. This bandwidth is not exactly 3 dB bandwidth or half power bandwidth that we are familiar with. We have to define this bandwidth slightly different fashion. It is the ratio of these two, this numerator and denominator. In numerator we have integration hf square df, and denominator we have hf0 square. This hf is the frequency response characteristics of IF amplifier, and f0 is the frequency of maximum response or the midband in band frequency. This BN bandwidth is called the noise bandwidth or noise equivalent bandwidth, and is the bandwidth of an equivalent rectangular filter whose noise power output is same as the filter with characteristics HF. The noise power in practical receivers is often greater than being accounted for by thermal noise alone, and is due to mechanism other than the thermal agitation of the conduction electrons. The noise figure Fn of a receiver is defined in this way: Fn equal to N0 by KT0 Bn into Ga, or it is the ratio of noise output of practical receiver to the noise output of ideal receiver at standard temperature T0, where N0 is the noise output from the receiver, and Ga is the available gain. The standard temperature T0 is taken as room temperature 290 Kelvin. The noise N0 is measured usually at the output of the IF amplifier before the nonlinear second detector. The receiver bandwidth BN is that of the IF amplifier in most receivers. The available gain GA is the ratio of the output signal S0 to the input signal SI. And KT0 BN is actually the input noise NI in an ideal receiver. So Fn is equal to SI by NI divided by S0 by N0. So the noise figure may be interpreted as a measure of the degradation of signal to noise ratio as the signal passes through the receiver. Now we have to modify the radar equation. The input signal may be expressed as SI equal to KT0 BN Fn S0 divided by N0. If the minimum detectable signal S min is that value of SI corresponding to the minimum ratio of output at the IF signal to noise ratio, means S0 by N0 minimum necessary for detection, then S min becomes KT0 BNFN S0 by N0 minimum. So if you substitute it, instead of S mean, we have to use this expression. Then we have the modified radar equation that can be written as R to the power 4 max equal to PTGAE sigma divided by 4 pi square. Then instead of S mean, we have to write KT0 BNFN S0 by N0 minimum. So this is one of the modification that we can make with the radar equation. Now consider SNR part. The result of statistical noise theory will be applied to obtain the signal to noise ratio at the output of the IF amplifier necessary to achieve a specified probability of detection without exceeding a specified probability of false alarm. The output signal to noise ratio thus obtained is substituted into the final modified radar equation we have obtained earlier. The noise entering the IF filter is assumed to be Gaussian, with probability density function can be written as conventional form PV equal to 1 by root over 2 pi psi 0 exponential minus V square by twice psi 0. The PV DV is the probability of finding the noise voltage V between the value V to V plus dV, and psi 0 is the variance or the mean square value of the noise voltage, and the mean of the value of V is taken to be 0. This is a 0 mean PDF. If Gaussian noise were passed through a narrowband IF filter whose bandwidth is small compared to its midband frequency, the probability density of envelope of the noise voltage output, this is shown by Rice, to be of the form of Rayleigh probability density function. So according to Rayleigh probability density function, PR is the envelope, R by psi 0 exponential minus R square by twice psi 0. So R is the amplitude of the envelope of the filter output. The probability that the envelope of the noise voltage will lie between the values V1 and V2 is, so probability V1 to V2 is the integration V1 to V2 of this density function. So R by Chi 0 exponential minus R square by cos Chi 0 dr. Also, the probability that the noise voltage envelope will exceed the voltage threshold Vt. Vt is the assumed to be the threshold voltage. That can be written as Vt to integration Vt, lower limit is Vt, upper limit is infinity of this probability distribution function. That is found to be exponential minus Vt square by twice Chi 0. This is called PFA, or the probability of false alarm. So whenever the voltage envelope exceeds the threshold Vt, a target is considered to have been detected. Since the probability of a false alarm is the probability that noise will cross the threshold, the equation gives the probability of false alarm denoted by PFA. The probability of false alarm by itself does not indicate that radar is troubled by the false alarm indications of target. The time between the false alarm, TFA, is the better measure of the effect of noise on the radar performance. The average time interval between crossing of the threshold by noise alone is defined as the false alarm time, defined as TFA for large value of n. So n tends to infinity, 1 by n, summation k equal to 1 to n Tk, capital Tk, where this capital Tk is the time between crossing of the threshold voltage Vt by the noise envelope when the slope of the crossing is positive. So consider the envelope of the noise voltage is the fluctuation like this. This is the RMS and this is the threshold. We have set threshold right here. The false alarm probability may also be defined as the ratio of the duration of time the envelope is actually above the threshold to the total time it could have been above the threshold. So PFA can be written as summation of small tk divided by summation of capital Tk, that is small t its small t is average and capital T is average. Now what is small t and what is capital T? Small t is the time for which the envelope is above the threshold. So this is the time for kth sequence. This is the time period for which the envelope is above the threshold is say Tk plus 1 small t. This is the time period for which the envelope is above the threshold is say Tk plus 2. And this time interval between two successive zero crossings is the capital T. So this one is say capital Tk, this one is capital Tk plus 1 and so on. Now this average ratio of these two averages can be written as 1 by TFA into B. The average duration of a noise pulse is approximately the reciprocal of the bandwidth B, which in the case of envelope detector is IF bandwidth. So TFA can be written as, from our previous expression of PFA, 1 by B IF exponential Vt square by twice Chi 0. Now we will consider the probability of detection. To consider the probability of detection along with noise, we will consider there is a sine wave signal of amplitude A to be present along with the noise at the input to the IF amplifier. The frequency of this signal is same as that of the IF midband frequency FIF. The output of the envelope detector has a probability density function given by PSR is equal to R by Chi 0 exponential minus R square plus A square divided by twice Chi 0 into I 0 R A by Chi 0. This I0 is the modified Bessel function of zero order and argument z. So array wise I0 is the argument of this modified Bessel function. When the signal is absent, that means in absence of any signal, means A equal to 0. And the above equation, this equation for PDF for signal plus noise reduces to the probability density function for noise alarm that we have discussed earlier. This is the Rice probability distribution function. Now, the probability that the signal will be detected, which is called the probability of detection, is the same as the probability that the envelope R will exceed the predetermined threshold Vt. So the probability of detection Pd can be written as Vt to infinity PSR dr. PSR is the probability. If we integrate over this interval Vt to infinity, we should get that probability of detection. So we have to integrate it. But analytically, we cannot solve it. So we have to take the numerical techniques. Now, much easier empirical formula is there. Albert Schem has given that particular formula between signal to noise ratio, PFA and PD. So it can be written as S by N equal to A plus 0.12 AB plus 1.7 B, where this A is nothing but log of natural logarithm of 0.62 by PFA and B is the natural logarithm of PD by 1 minus PD. So let us take an example. If TFA is 15 minutes and B is 1 megahertz, then PFA can be determined using the relation 1 by TFA into B, and that is found to be 1.11 into 10 to the power minus 9. So this is the probability of false alarm for this particular system. Now this is very important. If we consider only noise, so this is the plot of this distribution, right? And if we consider signal plus noise, say this is the plot. We set the threshold at voltage Vt. So here the x-axis R by root over psi 0. So this voltage becomes Vt by root over psi 0 right here. What is probability of false alarm when noise alone exceeds the Vt? That means this area is the probability of false alarm. What is probability of detection when the signal to noise ratio exceeds the threshold? So this area, this whole area, is the probability of detection, right? Now if we increase the threshold voltage, what will happen? So if threshold voltage is set right here, that means if threshold voltage is shifted towards right slightly, what will happen? This PFA area will be reduced, right? PFA area will be reduced. That means probability of false alarm will be reduced. But at the same time, it will reduce the probability of detection, because this portion will be lost now, this section. So increment in threshold will not only reduce probability of false alarm, but at the same time it will reduce the probability of detection. And if threshold voltage is shifted towards left, so what will happen? Probability of detection will increase, obviously. Probability of detection will be this area, whole area. But at the same time, probability of false alarm will also be increased. This one will be the probability of false alarm. So we have to select this Vt very, very judicious fashion. Otherwise, both the PFA and PD will be either increased or decreased without So what I want to say is that we have to select this Vt in very very judiciously. Otherwise, and that is the job of the radar engineer, for the proper selection of properly select the value of VT. Otherwise, both PFA and PD will not be in tolerable limit. This is what I want to say from this figure. Now the system design sequence. Both the false alarm time TFA and the detection probability PD are specified by the system requirements. The radar designer computes the probability of the false alarm using this TFA and the relation PFA equal to 1 by TFA into B. Then the required signal to noise ratio to achieve the above PFA and PD is determined. This is the signal to noise ratio that is to be used in the final modified radar equation we have already determined. This one here we have to use that particular signal to noise ratio to get the maximum value of R. So that's all for today. See you in the next class.